everyone, and welcome to the second half of the course. This is when we typically move from learning strictly about After Effects to kind of learning the art of motion graphics. Motion graphics is this sort of middle ground between animation and graphic design and honestly storyboard, because you have to create this moving artwork design that also captures people's attention but is simple enough that anyone can sort of get the message, or idiot proof for a lack of a better technical term. So this is really going to delve into focusing on your art and on your vision of what you want to communicate with motion graphics. The next project is going to be very detail-oriented, much more so than the other projects, which the goal was more for you to get into After Effects, start learning it, and start practicing it so that you could get into the art form that it is. So we're going to be shifting and talking about storyboarding first, and then getting into sort of the psychology of shape, language, and how you can use that in all of your designs, both design-wise and motion graphic. Please take this with a grain of salt, because all of these subjects have a billion hours that I could lecture on them. I'm going to give you a very brief lecture on the rules and sort of the regulations so that you can understand the language of not only movies and storyboarding, but also that you could use those rules and break them to communicate whatever you want to in your design. So we're going to delve right into it by going into storyboarding. Storyboarding is its own art form, okay? And I'm not lying. Storyboarding happens every single piece of at least good media that you see is storyboarded, whether it's live action, animated, a logo, an advertisement, anything has a sketch or planned out storyboard version of it. In movies or in TV shows, it's usually between sort of the writing stage and the, let's say, animatic editing stage, where it's basically the first pass of taking your words and putting them into a visual effect. This was not always the case. Pre the invention of film and the evolution of animation, there was a visual language, but it was only for paintings, for sculptors, for anything that obviously wasn't on the screen and wasn't moving. In a composition, you're controlling the eye around the canvas. You're saying, this is the center of the painting, or this is the brightest person that we're looking at first, and then we're controlling the eye movements to around the painting, to maybe noticing some different objects. Now, our eyes are actually trained to be attracted to what's brightest in the contrast and what is moving. If you are trying to survive in the jungle, or maybe a night in a cave, and you have really good eyesight, it's going to be to your advantage to spot the tiger that's running. Or if you're in a field, it's going to be to your advantage to see something moving in the grass. Animation and design takes that, and art in general is still building on that. They're still tracking your eye movements. They're still drawing your attention to what your brain is telling you is the most important. The thing that's closest to you, the thing that has the most contrast, the thing that's biggest, the thing that's going to draw your attention. And if you know that as an artist, you can really control what the viewer does and maybe doesn't see. Let's say if you want them to see a portrait, you're going to put that person forward, but maybe in the story there's a background that they didn't know, there's a mystery element, and maybe you're going to put something in the background that's not going to be so obvious, just like in the story. So the challenge was for these early film and animators to take this visual language of, let's say, color theory or anatomy of realism, and to translate it in, for all intents and purposes, a 2D space that moved. They couldn't sculpt, you know, you couldn't feel the movement. How do you take these Renaissance-esque rules of composition, of color, and translate them to something that's moving. If you are creating a painting, that painting is going to be a perfect composition because the viewer's eyes are always going to see the same thing. Maybe it'll depend on the different way you look at the painting or the sculpture or what angle, but for all intents and purposes, that thing is staying still, and that's an object. But with film, you have to take that art and you have to move it to the next frame and also make it art. You have to take that emotion that comes with paintings, with sculptures, with music, and you have to combine it all and track your eye movements and the audience to tell a story, to make them have emotion and to connect them to the characters. And that was a really evolving presence, especially in the early days of film and of animation, because how do you take 50 people who are all on different levels and communicate what you want the emotion of the scene to be, what you want the characters to talk like, what you want the composition, or let's say the still artwork of each frame that's moving, to understand what the writers want, what the artists want. And it's storyboarding. That's the blueprint, that's the first step. So, you take all of this and you put the weight on storyboarding, on creating every single shot planned out to create emotion, to connect, and to track your eye movements.
All of this to say that storyboarding is there as a blueprint for your design, but it's also a really, really essential part in how you communicate the emotion and the story that you are telling. Again, I am just going to skim the surface of this. There are books on storyboarding, but what you need to know now is that storyboarding and planning your design are there to create emotion and a connection with the audience, to track their eye movements, to track what they're paying attention to, and to make sure that they're paying attention and learning what you want them to learn or to communicate. This could be anything from bringing a story to life in the characters that you design. It could be visual gags. It could be a subtext message that you want to communicate later, or maybe foreshadowing. And then it could also just be manipulating your audience to, let's say, see this character as a good character instead of a bad character later. In design, this translates to what company you're representing and sort of what story you're representing. In this next project, you're going to be really delving into a story and communicating a title sequence. So you need to create a design that's going to, let's say, if it's a horror movie or a book that you're writing about, then you're gonna create a title sequence that is going to be maybe vintage, early 1900s. It's those sort of research concepts that start in storyboarding, and it's an important part of your plan. To give you a basic understanding, we're gonna look at a clip from the Mutant Ninja Turtles that has a really great example of how we use storyboarding to plan shots, to track eye movements, and to really control the audience's attention. So let's take a look at that first, just a run through, and then let's break it down.
Start chasing him down.
I like the place. No diggity, no doubt. Play on, play it. Play on, play it. Yo, Drake, drop the verse.
Chasing down, good lord. Baby got him open all the time. Strictly cause she don't play around. Come on, touch ground, that game by the time. Getting paid is a forte. Every day, to play away. Get her out of my mind. Wow. I think about the girl all the time. Wow. East side to the west side. Pushing fat guys. It's no surprise. She got tricks in the stash. Stacking up the cash. Fast when it comes to the gas. By no means average. It's on when she's got to have it. Baby, you're
a perfect 10. I wanna get in. Can I get down so I can win? I like the way you work it. Diggity. I like the way you work it. No diggity. No diggity. I like the way you work it.
Hey, 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 I don't talk, but if I did talk, I'd tell you it was Bad Bernie you were looking for, but you didn't hear from me, you know.
Where's Bad Bernie? Okay, I'll talk. Yeah, all right.
Okay, so let's break this down. I'm gonna do this without audio because even though this song is really good, it can be distracting. So we start on April, who is obviously an essential character, but notice the lighting. Storyboards aren't really done in color, and we'll get into this a little later, but color is a super essential part in communicating what you want the audience to feel. In this case, it's red. And so that communicates they're either going into danger or something's about to happen. It's not a calm color. So your attention is right over here, as you could see, and that's where your eye movement is, at the right of the screen. And then as it switches to the next shot, look, the tension goes here, but he is actually stretching. And these lines go, oh look, directly to the center of the screen where we should be looking for the next shot. And the next shot, look, it's these zoomed in buttons, again, center of the screen. And then we're at the center of the screen again. So at every single shot, we're connecting what's going to be next. So you see they're all at the center of the screen where your eyes already are. Then he makes this motion of anticipation where they're going to fight. And then you see this slight variation here. You are at the center of the screen before. He makes a movement where his arm is closer to the screen, specifically this contrast right here. This is the most contrast that we'll see, and that is where our eye will go. Our eye will always go to where the closest thing is to our eye, or most contrast, or whatever is moving. So we're slightly to the right. Remember when it was center? He's guiding us to where our eye should go. So they are also moving up and pointing to where should we look? Right here. Look at that. It was pointing to the other side of the screen where they are entering. And not only that, there are a lot of action lines that are pointing to. First of all, every single person in the shot is looking over. This person actually is holding something that they're anticipating to throw in this direction. And also, this has the most contrast. They have a lot of green here, and the light really kind of blurs out whatever else is in here. Even though this has a lot of contrast, we're looking at where we already pointed from, right? All right, let's keep going. So he's moving to the right of the screen, and it's pretty obvious they are just putting over every single character in the exact same spot for them easy to track. But whenever it does cut away, they clear the shot. Look, so he's going away. And then it uses the pillow or whatever line they cross, and then it's clear. Even for a second, where your eye isn't really staring at anything. But notice when something does pop up, it's almost in the exact same place that he was in the previous shot. Again, they're tracking your eye movements. And then she's in the same place as her previous spot. She's dragging, they're in the same spot. So in all of this, you're really getting a fantastic picture of not only where our eye movements are, a really smooth transition, but also in the storytelling of anticipation. It's a fight scene, so you start with red, and you're gonna end with that calming sound of
there's no music at the end of it. And that signals a change. So part of this planning and this designing is using the audio and the visuals combined to send the message of it's a fight, or this is a VR company, or I'm promoting a nonprofit educational program. They're paying me to do a promotional video. Anything like that, they're going to want you to get that message across. Notice the music. It really stops here and it focuses not only on what he is saying, but also it makes a shift between they're not getting the information before. They're just beating up people and they're getting more and more suggestions where to go, who to talk to. So this is a shift of we have the information. We're going on a different pace, and it subconsciously tells the viewer to pay attention, that this is going to be a turning point. Now, keep in mind, in this shot, they want you to root for the Ninja Turtles. You know, they are really good at fighting. They want you to feel that way. But think of the opposite of that. If you want someone to feel chaotic, if you want someone to feel unstable in the scene, you're not going to track the eye movement smoothly. You're going to go from one side to the other. You're going to make physically the viewer's eye go from one way to the other, as you would maybe in a fight, maybe in a strenuous situation, maybe in a post-apocalyptic world, maybe in some kind of stressful situation where you want the audience to feel what the character is feeling and connect with them. If you're going to do a title sequence on the story about the end of the world, it's not going to be like a happy, like you're not going to do a title sequence with a whole bunch of flowers. Or maybe you would do that and you would put strenuous music, or you would emphasize on what's being lost. You really can take advantage in the storyboarding stage and beyond, or in your foundational designs, on what the viewer is physically looking at. You could also do this in reference to other materials that they would notice. So let's say a really great example of this is in The Glass Onion, A Knives Out Mystery. Great movie if you haven't watched it. Where they routinely do this thing of zooming in on the main character, sort of in this reverent expression. And they often do this, especially in this one scene with the Mona Lisa, where they're making a contrast between this very famous painting, and in the story it has a very important point of being the character being wanting to be remembered as this eternal person associated with the Mona Lisa, when in actuality he's an idiot. So they're making you see those contrasts and making you feel those emotions of her connection to the Mona Lisa as sort of the true person that will be remembered or should have been remembered. And not only that, they're making a contrast between her race. This is a painting that's been idealized for years, and then they're telling a story of a woman who's been totally betrayed by all of her closest friends. So in this way, you're not overtly saying, hey, this is the evil person in the story. You're giving the audience a hint of, hey, there's a connection here, and you're giving a really great build-up to pay off. A thing that is very important for storytelling, again, may not be super relevant to your motion graphics and every single design, but you want to keep in mind is this sort of concept of setup and payoff. So setup is this concept of when you're telling a story, you're setting the premise, you're setting the desires of the character, you're setting the context of the story, and you're setting up to, let's say, the end goal. So we all kind of know what this is done in a good way and a bad way. For example, in a good movie, let's say Kung Fu Panda, it's set up from the beginning that he likes Kung Fu, that he maybe doesn't believe in himself, but he wants to be changed, he wants to make a difference. Sort of a bad version would be any movie that feels like it's throwing things in there last minute. the prophecy is true, and he also needs this separate scroll, and there's this thing that they didn't mention last time. So this can be used for murder mysteries, for any story needs a setup and a payoff, and it can also be used for designs. Let's say the student example is linked. She is setting up Pride and Prejudice as a title sequence, like you will be doing. And she's doing it in a way of telling a story of gossip, of telling a story of betrayal, of this sense of pride, and then it ends on sort of this marriage aspect of this concept of two parties coming together that were on separate sides. So she's making, not necessarily spoiling the story, but making the concept of setting up and paying off in her music, in her designs. The music builds, it emphasizes this period that she's starting from, and it pays off at the end with the title card. It feels complete, or it feels like at least it's setting you up to watch the TV show of Pride and Prejudice in theory. Now, another concept that will sort of boggle your mind, or at least it did when I learned it, is the psychology of shapes. Now, we sort of know subconsciously the psychology of color, which I will leave to you for more sort of research, but basically we all know that red kind of makes us feel anxious, at least at its most brightest hue, or alerts us of danger. Green, of different hues, nature, calm, etc. The psychology of shapes is actually taking each shape and understanding psychologically what that would mean for every person. Again, this is not, it's very broad in its definitions, going back to Kung Fu Panda. The psychology of a rectangle is order, it's very stable, it's putting something that is representing discipline, maybe, it's very structured. And a circle represents very nature-based, the circle of life, organic shape. Sort of these two contrasting. So think of when Poe goes up the stairs. He physically has to kind of discipline, or maybe working towards this discipline aspect of learning Kung Fu and of teaching in a different way that is the norm, or that him being in a different way that it's the norm. He has to go through this sort of rigorous training, the hero arc, if you will. But visually, we see him go up rectangles, and he is, in general, a shape of a circle. Now, when he goes to, let's say, the cherry blossom tree, which he's literally eating peaches, which are circle, and he's also talking to another character who is very organic, circle, Master Wu Wei, and he is by a cherry tree that is very circular. It's giving nature. It's giving growth. It's giving organic. And it also represents in the story that he's turning from wanting or overcoming the sense of discipline to looking internally at the nature of himself, what he has to overcome or maybe accept about himself, rather than trying to change it through discipline, is a change in the story or what you're communicating to the viewer, whether subconsciously or not. So let's go over some basic rules here. These technically are breakable rules. For now, they are not breakable rules. Again, if you would like to, for the audience to feel the opposite of these things, you have to know them well enough to do them. So, for now, not breakable. So the first rule we're going to go over is the 180 degree rule. You don't move the camera past 180 degrees between the character. So when they flip, the audience is not confused. Say two characters are talking to each other. One is going to be slightly to the right and one is going to be slightly to the left. So the visually, the audience can make a note that they are different. So this happens a lot in conversation scenes. It happens a lot in fight scenes. The character's always to the right in the screen and the other character's always to the left. This can switch, but only if the camera is panning around. A lot of these rules you will find are rooted in the fact that they're trying to idiot-proof the media. If you have a person that maybe is not as fast with their eyes, and then a fight scene is going too fast for them and the characters switch, they're not going to be able to tell who's fighting. So we're going to not do that. Again, this sometimes does not fully apply if you don't have a character in your design. You just want two contrasting things to be able to be told apart. Say in your story, you have an enemy and a hero. You want those to be on opposite ends of the screen to not only visually see that they're apart and they're different, but also for your audience to tell who's talking, who's the good guy and the bad guy, that sort of stuff. And again, in the future, you can mix this up if you want the audience to be confused, or maybe if you want the audience to feel like there's a gray area. Maybe there is no hero. Maybe there is no villain. Maybe you want them to switch. That fun stuff. Rule of thirds. This is easy. You simply divide your screen composition into three parts to keep the eye moving and not place something very often in the center of the screen. Usually the center of the screen is reserved for, let's say, title cards, something that's super important and super stable. Now, something called screen direction is something that we just saw with the Mutant Ninja Turtles. It's basically the term that a character is moving in the same direction if you cut in or cut out. Also, if the character is running or going somewhere, that you wait until they're completely off screen and then you change it, or it's called clearing the screen. A good cut is something that you can't really notice or tell, or maybe get used to if it's dramatic. So again, going back to your student example, she researched this specific kind of, it's called a Rari show, and it's this old type of camera that they used to have back in the 1800s where her story is placed, that would click slides and you would see different shows, kind of like those little cameras that you see, little plastic ones, and you press the button and the little dial goes. And so she made her cut that slide going across the screen. This is a little bit jarring because she doesn't clear the screen, but you get used to it because it's repetitive. And it also may put you in the position of, oh, you are a person in the 1800s. It's transporting you back to where the story takes place in the context of what you're trying to get the audience to feel. Now, staging. Staging is basically just the presentation of information or characters that has to be clear. You don't want every character or every shape in your design to be one cluster. You want it to be spread out to one, point to where you want the audience's attention to, and two, that you're not placing a lot of things around the edge of the frame. The edge of the frame is kind of a technical thing because when media is passed after you design this beautiful thing, it may be cropped, it may be taken in, it may be transported to different ratios, so you don't want anything to get cut off in any of your designs because it's taking place on the bottom side of your screen. To have a grid on where your designs or most of the attention should take place. Unless something is exiting off the screen, do not place it in the upper right-hand corner at the very edge of it. You want everyone in the audience to be able to see it. You want the slowest person's eye movements to be able to see it. I'll also have a bit more vocabulary for you. It's just kind of for your enlightenment. If you get out to, let's say, have a commission or get into a studio setting, they're going to be using these terms. So it's just for you to be aware of or maybe look back on when you need them. Again, I know not everyone that's taking the class is going to go into movie making, although I hope you all do. That is just kind of there for your knowledge. Or maybe my feedback, I will also be using these terms. Now, as we transfer to sort of like the planning and designing stage, I want to do some overarching thing. Know your audience. This is going to be for any media or paper that you write. You're going to really want to say, who is this book? Who is reading this book? Is it a children's book? Is it a horror book? Is it a book for elderly people? And know your audience. If it's a children's book, is it going to be bright and happy so that it gets children's attention? Are you going to have fun sounds? Or if it's a horror, are you going to do young adult? What do they like? What is sort of their attention span? Usually on average, the attention span for a shot is about 5 seconds until sort of someone starts to feel like it's being slow, unless you're intentionally doing that. Another thing is to research well first. The first thing that you want to do is to go in all of the different exploring technical options that you possibly can. You're going to want to take all of the research that you've done and basically funnel it into what you're going to use. Probably only 10% will end up in the final product, but let's go back to the student example where she basically did a whole bunch of research on what the 1800s were like, how did they produce media, how were they reading this book, what year, what fashion was it. She actually took illustrations from the original novel and she photoshopped them. So it ends up coming with a very well-rounded and well-informed design. And also in my experience, it helps you, for lack of a better term, BS your way through clients asking. If they're asking you why your design is the way it is and you don't know, and you just say you don't know, then you don't really come off as, I'm a fancy designer and you should hire me for more work. You want to know why you made that design choice. You want every single shot and design to be intentional with what the company is. What story are you telling? What do you want to come across? For this assignment, it's going to be the title sequence, or basically I'm your client and what I want, which is to you to make good media. But in other contexts, it might be someone in Beverly Hills who wants a real estate ad to be pink, all of it. And it doesn't really look good, you think, and maybe you won't put it in your portfolio, but it's what they want. And that's the most important. So I will link below all of the design principles and sort of the terms and maybe some more advanced detailed animation principles if you're going to be doing something that's really techie or beautiful or bouncing ball. You want something more specific, then you can go towards that. Again, this is not technically a storyboarding class or an animation class, even though those two things totally help you with presenting any media. This is about you creating your best work and you making those design choices consciously, and also that you know the context of which you're creating it. What kind of story are you telling? How are you going to tell that story? And why are people going to pay attention to your media rather than everyone else? And all of these rules really help not only plan that, but help you communicate to your audience, again, maybe not overtly, but you and the audience will know what you want them to look at and what you want them to feel. And this is sort of how movies and media manipulate our feelings and where we look and whatever else we do. So I hope this helps and you use it in sort of any other media design that you go into. And yeah, if you have any questions, as usual, please let me know. I look forward to seeing your next progress. All right, have a great rest of your day.